there is no doubt whatsoever that we would expect to see some measure of maturity in a believer such that we would not see the kinds of sins that we would normally see in an unbeliever. We would most certainly expect that. There is no question about that. The argument has to do with what is going to be the origin. And what I have found is that through the law, there is no opportunity for a change of heart. For us to suggest that we need to live by a set of rules and regulations, that we are to live by a particular lifestyle, that somehow that is going to change a heart, to me, that is nothing more than effectively behavior modification. And that is what many people are teaching, is effectively a form of behavior modification. All we need to do is somehow try and get the flesh under control through this new lifestyle, through this new way of life, through perhaps some accountability groups. And if we can just get the flesh under control long enough, then eventually perhaps the spirit might be able to catch up to it, and then we wouldn't have to have so many controls in the flesh. That is generally what's taught, and it's a form of behavior modification is what it is. But what the Lord has provided for us in the new covenant is something that is very different and much more real, and most certainly can have a very profound effect on a person's life. And I'm telling you about this from personal experience, because I do know what it's like to live a life wholly devoted to the law, with absolute pursuit of obedience to everything that the Lord has declared and to everything that the Lord has said. There was never any doubt of sincerity in my own heart or the desire for obedience, but one thing that I did recognize was that my own heart, in the deepest core of my being, was not really fundamentally changed, that there was still the sinfulness within me that was not being affected in any way by the law, and in fact there was more sin that was being stirred up. Because there were some laws that were being presented to me, and my own flesh would respond by saying, I don't know, don't be telling me what to do, I don't think I want to live that way, I think I'd rather just go ahead and be my own God, and I'm going to decide what I want to do regardless in this particular area that I'm just simply not willing to give up on. And sin would be stirred up through that. There were other sins that I never even considered, never even pondered, never even came to mind, that all of a sudden are now coming to mind because I'm preoccupied with the law that says, don't be doing these things. And I found that sin was being stirred up within me as well through that mechanism also. But then there was the religious pride that was being developed when I felt that I had found a way to actually live in obedience to the law, to live up to the expectations that I thought the Lord was placing upon me. That was something that I most certainly was not expecting. The expression of religious pride and the condemnation that I would then express towards others who were not living in the way that I managed to find a way to live. That was another type of sin that I didn't quite expect. But one thing is for certain, and that is that I most certainly realized that the law was stirring up a significant amount of sin. What I found, however, as I began to grow in my relationship with the Lord Jesus, as I came to discover that He was my Messiah, and as I came to discover what it was that He actually accomplished for me, and when I came to discover the actual implications of what He accomplished for me, then I began to experience a very different life, a very different way of life. Because as I came to recognize and realize that I had already been forgiven of all of my sins, that there was no sin that was standing as a barrier between myself and God, what I had committed in the past, what I was committing in the present, and what I was even going to commit in the future, all of those sins were paid for. He died for those already thousands of years ago. And when I came to realize that that was no longer His concern, that was no longer His preoccupation, and I realized that in the midst of my incredible sinfulness, His love towards me was so profound that He would die for me to that extent, then I began to really grow in His love, which meant that I was able to rest in the love that He had for me, and I was able to rest in the acceptance that He had for me. And what I found was something that was very interesting and something that I most certainly did not expect. And that was that I was no longer so preoccupied with trying to obtain love from others. I was no longer so preoccupied with trying to obtain the acceptance from others, because I was able to rest in the absolute perfect love of God, the absolute acceptance of God, the total and absolute unconditional love and acceptance of my God because of what He actually accomplished for me. I was able to rest in that to the extent that I was no longer preoccupied with trying to obtain that from others. I was then being set free so that I could share with others the perfect love and acceptance acceptance that I had already received from my God. And this was a very new thing. This was something that I did not anticipate. This was most certainly not something that I was expecting. And what I discovered was that the way that I began to relate to people was very different. If I was not dependent on their love for me, if I was not dependent on their acceptance for me, then the way that I related to them began to significantly change. I was no longer so preoccupied with trying to obtain something that, of course, they could never give. Instead, I was then preoccupied with trying to share with them what it was that I had received from my God. And let me tell you something, there are not very many opportunities to sin against your neighbor, to sin against those who are close to you, when you are preoccupied with trying to share with them the love that you have received. If you are loving your neighbor, it is unlikely that you are going to be violating them. If you are sharing with them the acceptance that you have received, then there is no longer the preoccupation with establishing conditional criteria for them to be able to receive your acceptance, because you are no longer preoccupied with having their acceptance. And this began the new relationship that I did not anticipate in any way whatsoever. And it was in this way that I began to realize how it was that the grace of God would change my heart. The grace of God would change my mind through receiving by His grace those things that He had available for me, His perfect love and acceptance, and the meaning and purpose in my life that I was created specifically by Him to receive only from Him. It was in the receiving of that. It was in the resting in that. It was in the trusting in what it was that He was giving to me. It was in abiding in Him in that way, in that capacity, that I was finally being set free in my own heart, so that my ability to engage with others was something that was a manifestation of the living God working within and through me, such that He could portray Himself within and through me, and then I would be able to stand as a reflection of the living God, an image of the living God, to bear testimony that there is actually a God who is a living and active participant in our lives right now and today. And in that way, people would also be able to see the truth and the reality that He is real, that He is alive, and in that way they may also, by some means, receive the gospel that is presented to them, so that they also may be able to begin to experience a personal relationship with Him as well. This was expressed by Paul in Titus, beginning in chapter 2, verses 11 and 12, where it says, "For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age." It says that it was the grace of God, and it is the grace of God that is going to change a person's heart, that will teach us to say no to ungodliness. It is only the grace of God. The law could never do that. The law never did that. The law only stirred up more sin. If the law could have accomplished that, then why did Jesus come? Why would He have to die for us? Why would He have to restore the spirit of life that had been lost in Adam? If we could have accomplished it through our own sincerity, through our own obedience, and we have had plenty of opportunities to try and make this work. You can see the history of Israel and all of the people thereof who gave it their most sincere effort. If it really could be done, if it really could be accomplished to the satisfaction of our God, if it really could be accomplished to the extent that we would be able to live a holy life, then Christ died for nothing, and the grace of God is nothing. The grace of God is not the little extra benefit that we need when we fall short of our pursuit of obedience to the law. The grace of God is everything that changes our heart through the fulfillment of what the Lord has made available to us, such that we can begin to engage the world with what we have and not with what we hope to obtain, such that we will then, therefore, no longer be sinning against our neighbor. That is how the grace of God will teach us to say no to ungodliness, where the law could never accomplish that. And so let me ask you, how is it that the grace of God teaches you to say no to ungodliness? If you think that the law of God will do that, if you think that the lifestyle that you have imposed upon yourself will do that, if you think that some accountability group structure will accomplish that, if you think that just by going to church, by being involved in some kind of organization, by being involved in a church or being a member thereof, if you think that that is the means by which you are going to have a changed heart, a changed life, then my friend, I'm going to tell you that you are most certainly missing out on the reality of the resurrection, because it is in the reality of the resurrection, the reality of what it is that the Lord Jesus has accomplished for us by dying for all of our sins, and so that he could restore the spirit of life that had been lost in Adam, so that this life that we receive will never be lost, so that we have the living God indwelling within us, his very life, his very Holy Spirit, who will guide us and lead us into all truth, and the acceptance and the love and the meaning and purpose that you can obtain through his indwelling you. If you are not resting in that, if you are not abiding in that, then you are most certainly not experiencing the grace of God. The grace of God in your life such that it will fundamentally change everything about your life. Through changing who you are by fulfilling the very deepest needs of your heart, and through the fulfillment that you experience in your relationship with him, your heart and your life will then subsequently be changed, whereas the law could never do this and will never do this. It is only the grace of God that will teach us to say no.
You have been listening to the broadcast outreach of Living God Ministries with Aaron Budjen. This broadcast is possible because of the prayers and contributions of our listeners. To obtain a copy of today's broadcast, send $5 plus $2 for packaging and postage to Living God Ministries, P.O. Box 38353, Colorado Springs, Colorado, 80937, or call 303-359-2550, that is, 303-359-2550, or look us up on the internet at www.livinggodministries.net. That's livinggodministries.net.